How does a network routing table get built inside a layer 3 network computer router? Like this one. We know that a router reads a destination IP address in the packet header when it comes into an interface on the router. And it looks at that destination IP address and it compares it to its own routing table. But how is that routing table built? And more importantly, can it be changed? Does it change? And if so, how?
Are you ready?
Hey, thanks for watching. I'm Clint Garrett, and we saw in the last video the steps a router takes to do its job as a router. But what we didn't look at was how the network router table is configured or built on each router on a computer network. How does that network router table know the networks around the router itself? To understand how routing tables work, we have to look at how a routing table entry or entries are made on a router. And to keep it simple, there are two basic ways routing tables are built. The first way or method, and the most simple way that a router table is built on a router, is if the administrator or the technician statically programs the routes into the table personally. This can be done by connecting to the physical router directly or by logging into the router and entering the routes into the routing table remotely over the network. Either way, you have to log into the configuration of the router to make that happen. Now, this can work great if you have a small to mid-sized network where potential changes to the network's physical layout are minimal or where there are no expected changes in the near future. However, I'm going to show you the following scenario on a computer network with static routing tables on every router to show you how those static routing tables can be detrimental to a network if any changes are made or if that network is a larger size. Let's suppose you have these four routers connected like you see in this diagram. All four routers have statically programmed routing tables on them, so the network admin or technician configured each router with their respective network routes for each of the networks or the local area networks, the LANs, that are connected to each of them. Assuming all routes were configured or programmed correctly on each router, you'll have a perfectly performing network as long as nothing changes. But if one of these routers fails, like man-made equipment always has the potential to do, or if someone removes a router, or if there is a power outage or any number of other scenarios causing one or more of these routers to no longer be connected on this network, you'll have a serious issue with packets dropping and networks not being connected to each other by these routers precisely because they have static routes programmed into them and they aren't aware, as a router can be aware, of any changes that have occurred on the network itself. In this scenario, if this middle router lost connectivity, went down, or was physically removed or changed, these other routers would still be trying to send them traffic for the routes and the networks they think are still on that path or connection. This can be bad, as an entire network can actually go down because of this. This leads us to the second method or second type of route table entry that's used on a computer network or on computer network routers to build routing tables, and that is known as dynamic routing. So we dealt with static routing, that's where you program in the routes. This is dynamic routing. Dynamic routing is where routers are programmed to talk to each other and tell each other their known routes and update each other with any changes detected on a network so they can all adjust their routing tables accordingly. This also, dynamic routing, also allows routers to provide multiple paths to different networks if something goes down. Dynamic routing also allows the routers to adjust and provide multiple pathways or connections to those networks if a router or a connection to one of those routers goes down. Let's say all four of these routers are using dynamic routing now, and something happens to this second router, just like the previous scenario. If they're using dynamic routing protocols, the routers that are still running and connected on the network will update each other to let them know the second router isn't there anymore. And each of those same three routers still running correctly will adjust each of their routing tables to keep network traffic moving the best way possible. So the first method was static routing. A human actually programs or configures the routes into the routing table on each router. That takes that human also knowing their network really well to make sure that they program the correct routes into each routing table. The second method is dynamic routing, whereby the routers communicate with each other with dynamic routing protocols, and they learn the routes to enter into their own routing table or tables, as well as make changes to their own routing tables automatically based on any physical changes detected on a network, like a router losing connectivity or going down, for instance. There are two categories of dynamic routing, or two types of dynamic routing protocols, is another way to say it, that you will need to know not only for the Network Plus exam, but with any work you do in your own networking career and or business. Link state and distance vector. In this short routing table tutorial, I'm going to cover each of them, again, from the 30,000 foot view to explain them as simply as possible. Now, we won't get into the minute details of each of the two dynamic routing protocols, at least not in this video, but I'll show you a basic idea of each. Distance vector routing protocols build their routes, learn the different networks and routes to those networks, and they list them in their routing table based on how they were learned and what distance, time and distance, is estimated it takes for traffic to reach those networks on those routes and connections. Now, some of the distance vector routing protocols you'll see used are things like EIGRP, IGRP, RIP, and RIPv2, or RIP and RIPv2. They sometimes call it just RIP. This table would be a good one to memorize or familiarize yourself with, as these are default administrative distances for each of these distance vector protocols. The second type of dynamic routing protocol is known as link state. Link state protocols are considerably better choices than distance vector for a couple of reasons. First, link state routers do not waste bandwidth by sending the entire route table back and forth to other routers like distance vector routing protocols do. Distance vector routing protocols will send the entire routing table back and forth, usually about every 30 seconds, to update all the routers around them or all of the other routers on the network, and that's regardless of whether there are any changes or not. Instead, link state protocols only send updates when a route actually changes, and these updates are sent using multicast, not broadcast, like the 30-second updates in distance vector protocols are. As soon as a network drops or is added using link state protocols, a link state advertisement, better known as an LSA, that's what stands for link state advertisement, is sent out to all the other routers to let them know. Each router then makes the proper updates to their respective routing table, and that leads us to the second major advantage to link state protocols being used, and that is convergence time. Convergence time is much faster than distance vector protocols, often within just a few seconds, again, compared to every 30 seconds when distance vector protocols are being used. Since routers using link state protocols hear about route updates almost as soon as they occur, and hear it directly from the router who, we'll say, owns the network, convergence is very fast. Now, examples of link state routing protocols are OSPF and ISIS, or some people call it IS-IS. So there you have it. Those are the two ways a network router table is built or learned on a network router, and I'd invite you to learn more detail about the dynamic routing protocols I just showed you, not only for the Network Plus exam and certification, but for your overall network career and or business in the near future. Someone who knows how to troubleshoot and design static routes or work with dynamic routing protocols will be a force to be reckoned with, and a person that's sought after in this industry at almost every level. So with all of that being said, I will see you in the next video.